And the next item of business is a debate without motion on behalf of the Local Government, Housing and Planning Committee on retrofitting of properties for net zero. I would invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or to enter R in the chat function. And I call on Ariane Burgess to open the debate on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Up to 10 minutes, please, Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The committee is delighted to have this opportunity to debate the retrofitting of housing for net zero. As a committee, we are beginning work on this, but it is not only an issue for this committee. It's relevant to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, and as we move closer to the deadline for the agreed net zero target, will be an issue for the whole Parliament. We hope today will help us as we consider next steps. Homes account for around 13% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions. To reduce emissions by 75% by 2030 and hit net zero by 2045, Scotland's homes will need to be far more energy efficient. The Scottish Government aims to reduce emissions from heat in buildings by 68% by 2030. There is a tremendous job ahead to deliver this target, and that is recognised in the Heat in Buildings strategy. As a committee, we agree that targets should be this ambitious. Before describing the committee's work and the challenges ahead, it's worth stepping back to consider what retrofitting involves and how it contributes to targets. Simply put, retrofitting means adding new technology or features to existing buildings to make them more energy efficient. This can include loft, floor and wall insulation, draft proofing and secondary double or triple glazing. As well as energy efficiency improvements, it's about installing zero or net zero emissions heating or connecting homes to heat networks supplied by low carbon or renewable heat sources. In Scotland, only 11% of households have no or low carbon emitting heating systems. The committee visited a retrofit project in Nidri Road, Glasgow. This project is concerned with retrofitting a tenement comprising of 8 one-bedroom flats. We were impressed with the work being done and thank John Gilbert Architects and Southside Housing Association for hosting us. We recognised the time and effort required to deliver a project of that scale. The Scottish Government proposes that homes must meet EPC rating C in future. In 2019, less than half of Scotland's homes were rated EPC C or better. There are around 2.5 million homes in Scotland, and when you consider the work involved in delivering Nidri Road, this may need to be done to more than 1 million homes, you realise the Herculean scale of the task. Presiding Officer, so how do we increase the scale and the pace? What must be in place? In November, we met stakeholders to explore these issues, and I'd like to thank them for participating. They raised a range of issues, and we agreed to write to the Scottish Government to seek its views on them. We started by asking how it intends to increase the pace of retrofitting. In doing so, we highlighted models of collective purchase, such as bulk buying, payment plans, community ownership, and third-party ownership. In its response, the Scottish Government recognised that the pace needs to significantly increase. It is looking at the models highlighted and working closely with stakeholders to develop them. We asked the Scottish Government what role it sees for local heat and energy efficiency strategies to set out long-term plans for decarbonising buildings and improving energy efficiency across local authorities. We note from the response that its intention is for each local authority to publish their strategy by 2023. Given the urgency of the situation, we hope these strategies can be in place before then. We note from the climate change plan that the Scottish Government has committed to considering how local tax powers, such as council tax, non-domestic rates, could encourage retrofitting. I would be grateful for any updates on the progress of this work. Yes.
I'm very grateful. I asked witnesses at the Net Zero Committee this morning whether communities were aware of the impending deadlines and any support that they might avail themselves of to do this retrofitting. I was told I think the answer is no to all of those questions, and then there's a lack of anywhere householders can go for knowledgeable expert advice that they can actually trust. How does the committee think that this could be changed or challenged?
Ariane Burgess.
Thank you for your question. I think that, as I said at the beginning, the committee is just beginning the process, and we are asking the questions of the Scottish Government and looking for those answers. So I'm going to continue because I've got a few more questions to ask myself on behalf of the committee. We know from the government's response that its intention is for each. We note from the climate change plan that the Scottish Government has committed to considering how local tax powers such as council tax and non-domestic rates could encourage retrofitting. I would be grateful for any updates on this progress. One recurring theme we heard about is the importance of public buy-in. Witnesses suggested that COP26 has raised public awareness of climate change, which provides an ideal opportunity to advance public understanding on the role of housing in reaching our targets. The public need to know what will be expected of them, how much it will cost, and how it will be paid for. We asked the Scottish Government about its plans to improve public awareness and the role of the National Public Energy Agency in improving this. It is pleasing to see that it recognises the importance of public awareness. I'm keen to hear more about the role envisaged for local authorities in improving public awareness. To drive this work, there must be adequate funding. We're concerned that not enough funding is in place to deliver these plans. This is our most pressing concern and what prompted us to initiate our work. The committee recognises that funding will be a joint effort between government, social landlords, private lenders and owners. However, even allowing for funding from different sources, it will be challenging to find £33 billion that the Heat in Building Strategy estimates is required. It was good to hear that the Scottish Government is establishing a Green Heat Finance Task Force to report by September 23. It would be good to hear more about this task force and how the Scottish Government intends to encourage investment in the interim. We also heard about the challenges of accessing funding. Derek Logie of Rural Housing Scotland described current funding as an alphabet soup, with challenges in knowing where to find funding and how to get it. I welcome the recognition of the importance of the consumer journey in the Minister's letter, and it would be good to hear more about what the Scottish Government will do to improve it. Brian Leask of Hjaltland Housing Association told us that funding for organisation is not being allocated strategically, but rather through a bid process. We were pleased, therefore, to read in the Minister's letter that the Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund is no longer allocated on a competitive basis. For retrofitting to work for all, it must be delivered in line with just transition principles. We recognise that the Heat and Building Strategy contains the principle of no detriment. We welcome this. Nobody should be worse off due to retrofitting their home. The committee also heard about the importance of a fabric-first approach and the need to improve the fabric of existing homes to make them more efficient, energy efficient. It is pleasing to see the Scottish Government's commitment to fabric-first and to legislate to require buildings to meet energy efficiency requirements. Of course, this will only work if there is public buy-in and funding in place. Funding and public awareness aren't the only challenges. There will be particular challenges around retrofitting in mixed tenure blocks. Witnesses suggested there is insufficient clarity on how this will be delivered in the Heat and Building Strategy. The Minister's letter is welcome in offering more detail on how some of these challenges might be overcome. We are keen to be kept updated on this. There must also be a skilled workforce in place. We considered the Heat in Building Strategy set out broad plans for putting in place such a workforce. The Minister's letter provides more detail on that, and we look forward to scrutinising the Scottish Government's Heat in Building supply chain delivery plan. The potential for 16,400 jobs being supported across the economy in 2030 due to investment in the deployment of zero emissions heat is a welcome prospect. The committee also recognises that challenges are more acute in a rural setting. We particularly noted the increased costs and skills shortages. The Minister's letter refers to the provision of more funding and the role for the island's energy strategy. We are keen to hear more about how the Green Jobs Workforce Academy will respond to the demands of rural settings. I also note that the existing Homes Alliance calls for a rural homes just transition package. I would be interested to hear the Minister's perspective on that suggestion. The committee also heard about the challenges of retrofitting under the current planning system. In some cases, planning departments placed obstacles in the way. We do not believe the two are in conflict. As noted in the Minister's letter, this is something we will consider further in the context of NPF 4. With such a significant task ahead, we must draw on the experience from elsewhere. It is pleasing to hear about the memorandum of understanding between the Scottish and Danish governments, and it would be good to hear more about what lessons the Scottish Government has learned from elsewhere. Finally, there remain challenges out with the control of this Parliament, specifically concerning VAT on retrofit work and electricity tariffs. These issues significantly affect the viability of delivering the retrofit agenda and doing so with just transition principles. We will pursue this with the UK Government and note that the Scottish Government is already doing so. In closing, I want to reiterate the enormity of this challenge. We must deliver on this as a Parliament. We must hold the Scottish Government accountable and ensure it does everything it can to make it happen.
Thank you. I now call on Patrick Harvey, Minister. Up to 7 minutes, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start, of course, by thanking the committee for their ongoing work on the issues arising from the retrofitting of buildings. It is, as Ariane Burgess closed her speech noting, an enormous challenge and one that we must confront together as a critical part of our response to the climate emergency. The challenge is significant in part because of the scale and pace of emissions reduction that we need to achieve across our building stock. It includes switching over 1 million homes from fossil fuels to zero emissions heating by 2030. It's ambitious because it needs to be. Parliament has set us the statutory requirement to reduce emissions by 75% by 2030. So what we're debating today is what we need to do in our homes and other buildings to deliver that. Not delivering it simply isn't an option. While we must be clear-eyed about the scale of the retrofit challenge, we must also recognise that investment in the heat transition brings great opportunities. Green jobs in a burgeoning clean heat sector, new skills and training, greener, healthier and more efficient homes and workplaces across Scotland. So last month I published the Heat in Buildings strategy, setting out an ambitious policy package to progress these objectives. And I'm not for a moment shying away from the fact that the actions we've committed to are only the start of a multi-decade programme of work up to 2045 and beyond, to be honest. This strategy is a strong foundation, but there is much work that remains to be done to realise this unprecedented transition. I'm therefore grateful both to the committee and to other members for joining this debate and for their input into the efforts to move to zero emissions heating and energy efficient buildings. And I'm keen that we develop a cross-party consensus to take forward this agenda. I want to highlight three broad issues that are fundamental to making the transition a success. The first is public engagement. And again, this is something that Ariane Burgess, the committee convener, mentioned. I was pleased, in fact, to hear that the committee witnesses suggested that COP26 had raised public awareness of the need for action. However, we do need to recognise that most people at the moment don't yet have a clear understanding of what that means for their homes. Zero emissions heat systems, such as heat pumps and heat networks, enjoy long pedigrees in many other European countries, but they are unfamiliar to most of us here. I want to see that change, but I want to see it change in a way that engages people in a shared understanding of the need for that change and how to make that change. The upcoming dedicated National Public Energy Agency will indeed play a central role in public engagement. It will also support the streamlining of our delivery programmes, bringing new coordination and leadership, making it straightforward for people to access advice and support as and when they need it. The second point I want to touch on is certainty. Building owners need certainty on what's needed to meet the requirements of net zero, and the supply chain requires sight of a clear pipeline in order to invest and grow their businesses. So a critical component to our approach of creating certainty will be to introduce regulations. Building on existing standards that are already in place, requiring action on both energy efficiency and zero emissions heating, will introduce regulations that will, from 2025, require all homes to reach a good level of energy efficiency, EPCC or equivalent, for example, at point of sale or change of tenancy. Regulations from the same year will also begin to require buildings to take action on their heating systems as we phase out the need to install fossil fuel boilers. Later this year, I'll publish a consultation on those proposals. I'll bring forward legislation during this parliamentary term, and I look forward to working with the appropriate committees as well as the wider Parliament on developing those regulations. The third... yes, I'll give way.
Liam Kerr.
Just on that point, so if the Minister brings forward these regulations and mandates all of these changes, how does he expect people to pay for it?
Minister.
Well, by a happy coincidence, the very next paragraph in my speech begins, the third issue I wish to raise is cost. And I do recognise that people, including members and members of the public as well, have very serious questions. And at the beginning of a multi-decade programme of work, no government would be in a position of saying exactly what is going to happen right through to 2045 and beyond. But we've committed at least £1.8 billion in this parliament to kickstart the growth in markets for zero emissions, heat and energy efficiency, and to support those who are least able to pay. I'm pleased that this morning we announced almost £9 million of support through the Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Programme, with an impressive variety of projects that will provide zero emissions heat across homes and non-domestic buildings. One project in particular will be of interest from a retrofit perspective, a grant of £1.27 million to the reheat project led by Scottish Power Energy Networks to install heat pumps in 150 homes, along with smart controls and innovative heat batteries manufactured by SunAmp in East Lothian. Forgive me. Sorry, Presiding Officer. As well as decarbonising the homes that are participating in that project, it will generate insight into how a greater role for electricity in heating our homes can be accommodated by the grid, minimising the need for capacity upgrades and so driving costs down. Public investment in this heat transition is critical, but again, we have to be clear-eyed. We do estimate the total cost of the heat and energy efficiency retrofit transition to 2045 to be in the region of £33 billion, a sum that is clearly beyond the level the public sector could bear alone. So alongside public investment, we need innovative mechanisms to increase individual and private sector investment into energy efficiency and zero emissions heating. We are therefore establishing the Green Heat Finance Task Force to recommend ways that the Scottish Government and private sector can collaborate to scale up this investment. The task force will provide an interim report by March next year and final recommendations by September of that year. A just transition means sharing the benefits of climate action widely, whilst also ensuring that the costs are distributed fairly. This means that we must continue to support those who are least able to pay, and that's why we'll publish a refreshed energy strategy and just transition plan later this year. But it also means that those households, organisations and businesses who do have the means will share some of the costs, particularly where they benefit directly. Presiding Officer, the transition to zero emissions heat will be an enormous project around which we must work together if we're going to play our part in halting damaging climate change. I'm proud of the leadership that we're showing in Scotland, and I welcome the contributions being made both within this Parliament and across the country to charting an effective and fair course to decarbonising our buildings.
Thank you. I now call on Miles Briggs. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to open this debate for the Scottish Conservatives and welcome the opportunity to discuss this important issue which the committee have brought today. And challenge is most definitely, I think, the descriptive word for this debate. The Scottish Government have committed to decarbonising the heating of 1 million homes in Scotland by the year 2030. This is serving as a prelude to the aim of zero emissions from buildings by 2045. Now, this was set out in law, as the Minister has already outlined, in the Climate Change Act of 2019. Scottish Conservatives agree with that and have that a commitment to share the government's ambition to achieve that and the desire for us to make sure that Scotland leads by example in the fight against climate change. This SNP Green government has launched their heat and building strategy, as the Minister also outlined, following the consultation which ran between February and April. And a key part of that, and has already been raised, is how will householders and tenants be able to meet this challenge? Because heating accounts for roughly 50% of energy use in Scotland, and in order to cut greenhouse gas emissions, it is important we reduce our reliance on fossil fuels and instead move towards low or zero carbon heating systems. Now, from the outset of the debate, I think it's important to say that at the time of rising energy bills, and with the increased focus on tackling fuel poverty, it is critical that ministers do not lose sight of these challenges as well as we take forward this work. It's also important that whilst we're seeking to achieve this, we keep heating bills as affordable as possible and affordable levels. Most effective way of actually doing that is to reduce energy need of homes with better insulations and home efficiencies. And that's something I hope we can see real investment brought forward at an earlier stage. As it stands, homes account for approximately 13% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions. So there's also a huge amount of work beyond what is being outlined in Warm Homes campaigns and targets. Now, it's absolutely right that Scotland sets itself the ambition and pioneering targets that focus on improving energy efficiency in our homes, and we make sure we do move towards zero emission heating systems. That said, the SNP Green government proposals are long overdue and require significantly higher investments so that these targets may be actually reached. There's significant questions around how these targets are actually going to be met, and indeed the workforce who will be actually tasked with undertaking so much of this work. The Construction Industry Training Board, for example, found that to retrofit Scotland's existing built environment for net zero, a revolution will be needed across the construction sector to be able to achieve that. It's estimated that 22,500 people in Scotland will be needed to be trained to actually deliver this energy efficiency by 2028, and we have not seen any workforce plan work started on that. So I think that is as equally important to this debate. Scottish Conservatives will continue to press this government to deliver the investment required to achieve these goals and ensure that they are cost effective and that proposals do not disproportionately place a burden on homeowners and tenants. Now, as part of my work as a member of the Local Government Committee, I also sit on the Social Justice Committee, and we've recently also undertook to take evidence with regards to fuel poverty. And what was concerning was tenants from Glasgow who gave us some evidence with regards to the changes they've seen with the fitting of heat source pumps to their properties. Now, they've expressed significant concern in a number of areas, and I hope the Minister will take this on board, that these new systems have been significantly expensive and have actually, in a number of cases, pushed them into fuel poverty. Housing associations have not listened to their concerns, and they've not been properly consulted while these have been fitted to their properties. Now, I believe we need to really take that on board, because we need to take people with us on this journey, and I think tenants in Glasgow deserve better than they've said to us they've currently received. Now, the retrofitting of existing buildings with relevant carbon neutral technology will form an integral part of Scotland achieving net zero by 2045. And I hope that the Scottish Government ministers will provide more detail and explain how this can actually be reached while remaining affordable for homeowners across Scotland. In keeping with our own manifesto promises in 2021, the Scottish Government have supported the creation of Help to Renovate schemes as a way of supporting homeowners making their properties more energy efficient. And we welcome that, but we want to also see how the Rural Transition Fund will be used, because we know one of the hardest set of properties which actually will be needed additional funding to help meet that target are actually in rural properties and rural parts of Scotland. And this brings me to the specific point with regards to the heat in building strategy, which the Minister touched upon, and how we can actually make sure energy efficiency improvements are put in place, because some of the first parts of that work could be around wall and floor insulation. And I think that's a vital part of helping to reduce emissions, but make properties more efficient. And I hope that's maybe where we will see early emphasis on rural properties, especially where this can be partly funded and supported. There's much work to do, and I think certainly this debate can present an opportunity for us to take this work forward. Looking at the statistics which the government have already presented, only around 11% of Scottish homes, 278,000, have a renewable or very low emission heat system. This does not include 34,000 homes, for example, which are connected to network heat systems. And I think the development of network heat systems is a very exciting opportunity, which we should see also funding brought forward. To date, as the Minister has outlined, only £1.8 billion has been committed towards meeting these challenges within this parliamentary session. And I think it's furthermore worth noting that the government have actually missed their legal emission targets in 3 years in a row. So to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, while we agree that Scotland needs to decarbonise and tackle fuel poverty at a time when energy bills are soaring and cost of living is increasing under this government, we need to make sure that we work towards making this as efficient for homeowners. The Scottish Government have not yet allocated resources required for this plan to be met, and we need to make sure that reasonable support is provided to homeowners. So we call on the Government today to work cross-party to meet this challenge, and I hope today's debate genuinely starts a more focused and cross-committee work to make sure that the Parliament holds ministers to account for all this legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Mark Griffin. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest as an owner of a rental property in North Lanarkshire. Retrofitting and decarbonising our homes has been a huge focus of our working committee since June, so this debate is a welcome start to discuss the benefit and the cost of retrofit. Now, there was a partial email blackout yesterday, but unfortunately not a full one, so colleagues might know already what I have to say this afternoon. But part of that is the enormous bills that householders will be liable for, averaging £12,500, and that will be a huge concern to homeowners and tenants alike. And the £1.8 billion from the government committed so far just won't cut it. And the cost, as Susan Aitken told the Net Zero Committee outright last week, will run into the tens of billions. But it's the cost of living crisis that we face that makes those sums even more concerning. The panic about rocketing energy bills is palpable, so it's a bitter irony that it's the recovery which will cause the number of people in fuel poverty struggling to heat their homes, already affecting one in four, to spiral. Now, we agree we are in a climate emergency. We agree that if we improve the fabric of our homes, that we can cut fuel poverty, decarbonise them, reduce living costs, and create vital local jobs. We know our homes contribute 3/4 of the building emissions warming the planet. But the fact is, no one wants to hear low-income homeowners have to fork out thousands of pounds to sort it. And right from the start, the government's pushing too much on homeowners and tenants who will ultimately pay in their rents too quickly with too little support. And these are big, disruptive changes with real risks for homeowners. It is complicated. Homes need to be made energy efficient, reducing our energy demand and expenditure, then replacing heating systems with one that is carbon free. There are questions about some of that technology, and communities know that cowboys operate in that sector, often causing more harm than good. Early experiences of carbon-free heating systems are mixed. Social rented tenants and new build buyers have been the guinea pigs so far. North Lanarkshire Council told me their retrofits and heat pumps installations have achieved fantastic results against oil heating, with one tenant seeing bills dropped by 80%, but another housing association has told me that they are removing an unreliable district heating schemes, and tenants at another in Glasgow are being served with disconnection notices, because the costs of that district heating scheme are well above forecast and tenants can't afford to pay their bills. Now, others in the Western Isles have had infrared heating panels fitted and they're also getting huge bills, and many of those have had no recourse to have the systems removed or remediated or the exceptional costs underwritten. And we believe that households should be protected from the huge upfront cost of retrofitting through grants and loans to protect households and to crucially test that technology in the real world. But until the costs are comparable to a fossil fuel system, the likely point of adoption, is it not right to ask if the excess costs of installation and remediation is underwritten by government, expanding on the no-tenure principle set out in the heat and building strategy and set out by the committee convener? Happy to
Minister.
I'm grateful, and I suspect if it was possible for the public sector to fund every penny of this transition and relieve all homeowners of making any contribution, we would all love to do that. But can the member suggest a way of funding that? Is he actually suggesting that we do more than is in the heat and buildings strategy and pay for every penny of it from public funds?
Mark Griffin.
Come on to set out the other issues around cost, particularly for tenants. But I'm not saying that the public sector should fund all of this. What I'm saying is that low-income households, already struggling with their fuel bills, shouldn't have to bear the brunt of these costs. And not saying that they have to have the costs entirely paid for by the state, but if the state could cover the upfront costs so that they could be staged in a much longer timescale through grants or potential loans. But I've come on to the cost to tenants as well. I think this also makes the case for rent controls being introduced in this Parliament as soon as possible, so that tenants are then not left picking up the bills and the costs for social landlords making the changes to their homes. Now, the SFHA's own modelling for new energy efficiency standards say that they would only reduce fuel poverty by 24%, but is due to cost $2 billion. To decarbonise the heating source too would cost $6 billion. And their members say that the EPC model costs are likely to underestimate the true costs. And concern as well was echoed by Chris Morgan, an architect working on the Nidri Road demonstrator, trying to get a Glasgow tenement to InnerFit or Passive House standard, saying that EPCs do not measure the energy efficiency of buildings particularly accurately. Presiding Officer, the STUC have said that we need to learn from past transitions. Done wrongly, decarbonising our homes could push costs onto tenants, increase fuel poverty and lead to work needing to be done. And if we don't recognise that and make supporting homeowners and tenants our primary goal, and we won't have their confidence, and decarbonising our homes won't be the success that we all hope it can be. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Liam MacArthur. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr MacArthur.
Can I welcome the Local Government Committee initiating this debate? I know, as the convener says, they're in the foothills of the inquiry, although they've already, I think, set out clearly some of the key issues they'll be looking at in more detail. We know that 50% of energy use is through heating, as Miles Briggs reminded us. And while we must drive up new building standards, we know that around 80% of the existing housing stock is still going to be around in 2050. So retrofitting is going to be absolutely crucial. And this affects households and businesses in every part of the country. So I think it is appropriate that members, not just on the relevant committees, have an opportunity to contribute. So I'm grateful in that context to those who have supplied briefings for this debate, including those who did so inadvertently. And I would reassure Mark Griffin's colleague that we've all been there. In the short time available, though, I want to focus on three key areas: on cost, on capacity and on communications. On the first, we know that the heat and building strategy comes with a £33 billion price tag. Funding of around £1.8 billion has been announced, but there is little clarity around how this will be used. I think the Local Government and the Climate Change Committee have both expressed some concern about the need for greater transparency, a breakdown about how plans will achieve the pathways towards net zero. And in part, this is needed in order to track progress, or indeed the lack of it. But down at a micro level, the Scottish Government estimates that the average cost for installing a heat pump and improving energy efficiency is around £12,000 per home. In island and rural communities off the gas grid, however, we know that the costs are significantly higher. According to a written PQ response from Michael Matheson, this is around £17,000. Although I can certainly confirm in the smaller islands in my own constituencies, the cost in those smaller islands is considerably higher still. And these are also the communities that have traditionally experienced the highest levels of fuel poverty and extreme fuel poverty. So I think it's incumbent upon ministers to be absolutely upfront about the funding that's available and what is realistic in achieving the objectives, the cost contribution expected from individual householders and businesses, and that the targeted support will be provided to those least able to pay or those who are facing higher costs due to their island or rural locations. As with the cost, there seems to be a bit of a mismatch between the government's aspiration and the capacity to deliver. There's no doubt, as the Minister, I think, rightly said, that we can see the creation of green skills and green jobs, but wishing it were true won't simply make it so. Scaling up, for example, heat pump installations from 3,000 to 200,000 a year is going to take a lot of people, it's going to take a lot of training and an awful lot of investment, and it's unclear how this will be achieved in the timeframes envisaged and across the different parts of the country where it's required. And so finally, to the communications issue, the heat and building strategy acknowledges, as indeed the Minister did himself, that public understanding of the role of heating in causing greenhouse gas emissions is low. It's a concern that I think the convener emphasised in her own opening remarks, and I know the committee wants to see a process for accessing advice and support that's as easy as possible. This is a point picked up by the Just Transitions Commission that warned of the dangers in this area. They stated, the backlash against implementation of new regulations on smoke and carbon dioxide alarms shows how this can go wrong, and we must not risk the same happening for our transition to net zero. Indeed, Energy Action Scotland confirms, and I quote, in many hard-pressed families there is no recognition of net zero. They will have many other issues to deal with. They could feel further alienated or excluded from moves towards net zero if it isn't well communicated. So I welcome this debate. I wish the committee all the best with its inquiry and confirm Scottish Liberal Democrats support the drive to net zero through retrofitting. However, on cost, capacity and communications, the rhetoric is running well ahead of the reality at this stage. Thank you.
Thank you. And before we turn to the open debate, could I remind all members to ensure that their cards are properly in and that they have pressed the request to speak button if seeking to speak. I would also advise that there is no time in hand and therefore any interventions will have to be absorbed within the speaking time of the member concerned. And I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Liam Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my register of interest? I'm a serving councillor on East Lothian Council. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this very important debate. Only in November, the world came together here in Scotland for the COP26 climate change conference, obviously to discuss our collective goal of net zero by 2050. The Green Alliance Executive Director and beyond COP26 Chair Sean Spear said, there is no simple off-the-shelf solution to reaching net zero, but there is a growing understanding of what needs to be done. We need to build on that here in Scotland. The penultimate day of COP26 was dedicated to cities, regions and the built environment. Why? Simply put, there is now a clear recognition that the industries of the built environment are capable of doing more to help solve climate challenges and reduce emissions. In 2019, the World Green Building Council released a report that indicated that the built environment is approaching half of global carbon emissions, far higher than any other sector. It's no surprise, then, that reducing emissions from our homes and buildings will be one of the most important things we can do to end Scotland's contribution to climate change. We've heard the figure already today. In Scotland, our homes account for 13% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions. We have some of the most ambitious climate change targets in the world, reducing emissions by 70% by 2030 and net zero by 2045. It's been mentioned before by the Minister, the Scottish Government Heat and Building Strategy sets out how we plan to improve energy efficiency and support the decarbonisation of Scotland's homes. In the most recent report, the Climate Change Committee said that Scotland was ahead of the rest of the UK in setting out building decarbonising policy. But we need to do more. Retrofitting existing homes has a significant role to play in addressing the concerns of most households across Scotland in terms of energy costs and carbon consumption, and can help us make fuel poverty a thing of the past. The Existing Homes Alliance recommended that local authorities lead on the scoping of work required in their own area, and I think that's really, really important. My own constituency, East Lothian, is going to be different, and we've talked about the challenges of how we need to do that in Highland areas. I welcome the finance task force that the committee has been mentioned by the Minister as well. And the committee has a role of leading on both this and the approach in terms of the scoping and in the finance work. The Scottish Government has already committed to decarbonising the heating of at least 1 million homes, and that's a big challenge, as I've heard across that today, but it's one that has to be done, an equivalent of 50,000 non-domestic buildings by 2030. This, and any action we need to take to decarbonise our homes, must be done in a manner that protects those in or at risk of fuel poverty. We can't make these changes and risk putting more people into poverty from increased energy bills, and that avoids placing a burden on those least able to pay for the transition. In the written evidence to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, the Existing Homes Alliance made it clear that we should use the green recovery and net zero transition as an opportunity to build a more inclusive, resilient and net zero society. And that there is absolutely no excuse for poor energy performance of the home to be a reason to be in fuel poverty. The Heat and Building Strategy sets out the significant actions the Scottish Government is taking, including only taking forward actions where there is no detrimental impact. And again, that has to be fundamental on how the committee takes forward this issue, unless additional mitigating measures can also be put in place. But Scotland does not have all the powers necessary to deliver the transformational change required so that no one is left behind. We all know about the recent wholesale energy price increases and the potential impact on consumers further underscore the urgent need for UK Government action. And this has to be done on a long-term basis. We can make the changes, but if we still have issues around about wholesale energy prices, that's going to have a detrimental impact. The Scottish Government's plan of whole house retrofits and zero emissions first approach have been adopted and will prove vital in fuel poverty-proofing homes and will avoid costs of repeating inventions or replacing fossil fuel heating in a few years' time. So we urgently need a stronger commitment and a clear action plan on heat from the UK Government to prevent undermining of the Scottish Government's attempts to bring every single Scottish household along with us towards a net zero Scotland. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, retrofitting gives us an opportunity to tackle fuel poverty and move us towards net zero Scotland. As we heard in the ScotWind statement as well, it also gives us opportunities around about in developing new skills, new supply chains and, of course, skilled jobs. I look forward to working with all my constituency in developing this vitally important sector. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Liam Kerr to be followed by Fergus Ewing. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Retrofitting properties for net zero is no doubt an ambitious goal, but there is a significant credibility gap here, particularly when it comes to the roughly 170,000 homes, that's about 7% of the total, that are off-grid. Now, the Heat and Building Strategy requires that zero-emissions heating must be installed in all homes by 2045, with no new or replacement fossil fuel boilers in off-gas properties after 2025 in favour of zero-emissions heating. Now, I want to reiterate a point that Liam MacArthur made. When I asked the Cabinet Secretary how much it will cost to upgrade a typical hard-to-heat off-gas grid home, the Cabinet Secretary told me that the average cost could be in the region of £17,000. And in a further answer, the Minister conceded, while the output temperature of a heat pump is often lower, when appropriately configured with building fabric and radiators or underfloor heating, they efficiently bring indoor temperatures up to adequate levels. Underfloor heating, Presiding Officer. Some organisations suggest such works could increase the cost to around £30,000. For homeowners, who are often some of the 25% who are already in fuel poverty. Indeed, a recent poll of over 1,000 rural households found that 33% were unable to afford to spend any money on a new heating system. Now, the Cabinet Secretary tells me they could get a loan of £15,000, but this still leaves a minimum extra £2,000 up front, as well as, of course, paying back the loan. And nowhere does the strategy address whether electric heat pumps are the best option, practically or financially, for rural or off-grid homes. Presiding Officer, after Storm Arwen, I had innumerable constituents contacting me during the electricity outages expressing how lucky they were to still have fossil fuel fires or heating. Now, in fact, there are around 120,000 off-grid... Bear with me if I have time, Mr Ruskell. There are around 120,000 off-grid homes in Scotland which either use LPG or oil heating. The cost to people who use oil heating of switching to LPG or bio-LPG is about £2,000. Those currently on LPG can switch to bio-LPG without any intervention cost. Or maybe they want to explore biomass. Extensively used in places like Scandinavia and Canada, these can be installed easily and locally at a cost of about £8,000 and offer a genuinely circular net zero economy. Yet how does the Scottish Government explore these technologies? By proudly announcing, we have already phased out oil and LPG boilers from Warmer Homes Scotland area-based schemes or Home Energy Scotland loans, and forcing electric-only options on off-grid households. Presiding Officer, last week I met with Liquid Gas UK, a trade association with around 100 members. I learned a great deal which could help the transition for rural and off-grid Scotland on the journey to net zero. But I also learned that Patrick Harvey, the minister who is responsible for this area, hasn't actually met this group at all since being appointed, and neither has the Cabinet Secretary. Presiding Officer, the point I'm making is that there is no one-size-fits-all solution to any of this, whether it be energy generation or a satisfaction of demand. Clearly, a mixed technology approach to heating is essential to achieving net zero targets, and especially when it comes to off-grid properties. There is a serious disconnect between the £33 billion cost of this and the Scottish Government's lack of planning, lack of engagement and lack of financing. It is surely incumbent upon us all to work collaboratively with our partners across the United Kingdom, and as Miles Briggs said, across this Parliament, to find solutions, to consider all options dispassionately and against both the science but also the practicality, and to actually meet and hear from those in the industry best placed to help with that. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Presiding Officer, Mark Wilcock is 58 years old. He works for HIE. He lives in Nairn, has done for 2 years, where he purchased a flat in a tenement of flats where a bank had formerly carried out business on the ground floor. He chose to live in Nairn for its natural beauty, its history and the lifestyle that it offers. The building was constructed in 1874. It's a listed building. The flat is now drafty. The windows need to be replaced. He obtained a quote for UPVC windows of £4,500, but was then advised, because of the listing, sash and case windows would be needed. The overall cost of replacing them, and there's only six, would be £16,000. That's over three times the cost of UPVC replacement. This is not a bill that he can afford. I raised this case and aspects of it with the Scottish Government, and I have to say, Minister Jenny Gilruth, who arranged the call with senior officials from Historic Environment Scotland, have both been extraordinarily helpful, and dialogue continues as to how this work needed can be done in order to bring the standards of heat insulation up to those required. Though only a small proportion of homes in Scotland are listed, maybe 1%, they are commonly affected in this way by much higher costs of work required to bring homes up to higher standards of insulation, which in turn is essential if there is to be efficient use of fuel, less emissions, and therefore a less severe impact on the environment. Mark has allowed me to raise his case today, and I'm grateful to him. But I would ask the Minister, how can people in this condition be assisted in order to tackle what seems to be a very practical problem? For every Mark, there could be thousands of others. A second constituent who contacted me raised the case, and again she's a flat owner, of cases where there is one or more flat owners in a tenement who, for whatever reason, are not willing to agree to common repairs, which are essential, or perhaps to pay for them. The so-called missing shares case. And I understand that some councils in Scotland, and I think Edinburgh have taken a lead, and perhaps Glasgow, I'm no expert in any of this really, but some have taken a lead in actually paying for the costs of the recalcitrant or non-cooperating owner recuperating them afterwards. And this has been highly successful, Presiding Officer. So will the Minister bring in a national scheme? Because my constituent, Inverness, has no access to this, nor do many, mostly in rural constituencies where perhaps there are fewer tenements, but there are still many tenemental owners. Now, I raise these two issues because I think, Presiding Officer, unless we tackle the existing problems that face flat owners throughout Scotland, we are kind of missing the point. Of course, we all want to see net zero achieved, but what about the here and now? What about people that are faced with an impossible position right at the moment? And will the Scottish Government bring forward the missing share solution by providing a national fund to that effect? In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would like just to mention that in preparing for this debate, I did read an excellent piece of analysis, a report by Douglas Robertson, an expert, acknowledged expert in housing. The report, somewhat provocatively but accurately, describes is entitled "Why Flats Fall Down." We have got a very serious problem with structural failures in flats in Scotland. And the problem here and now is to get essential repairs done and to improve the housing stock now. Otherwise, there may be considerably fewer flats left in tackling the problems in future of net zero, which the Minister has described.
Thank you. I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the committee for the excellent work they have done here. We are all agreed that we have to reduce carbon emissions by retrofitting our homes, and I want to speak about today is the wide gulf as to where we want to be and our ability to achieve it. In fact, many speakers so far have addressed the same issue. Because importantly, if Scottish householders have to be adequately supported to make the changes and they must have the confidence in alternative heating systems, have we even agreed what the trusted alternatives are? Mark Griffin, Liam MacArthur and Liam Kerr have actually hit the nail on the head here by raising some of these issues. And I'm seriously concerned that ordinary families and workers have no idea how to take this forward. And I know the Minister has tried to address this so far. But the majority don't have £7,000, £10,000, £14,000 to spare in a new heating system. And even if they did, who's going to guarantee that the purchase of a zero carbon heating system will reduce their heating bills? Or will it be genuinely more efficient system for their homes? I mean, there's a lot to consider, and not just the financing of it. The International Energy Agency states that gas boilers should no longer be sold from 2025 if net zero has to be achieved. Electric heat pumps and air source ground source are seen as the most effective alternatives to gas boilers, but they can cost anywhere from £4,000 to £14,000 to purchase and install, which presumably is why demand remains low. Last year, the UK government announced 5,000 grants for homeowners in England and Wales to install heat pumps. In contrast, Home Energy Scotland offers households a maximum interest-free loan of £2,500 to install a heat pump, but it has to be paid back within 5 years. So you can see that there's a wide gulf here between where we'd like to be and where we actually are. Demand is currently so low that last October, Home Energy Scotland approved a loan funding for only 80 hybrid heat pumps, and the previous year loans approved were in single figures. The cost of retrofitting is eye-watering. For some in the region I represent, Glasgow, Council Leader Susan Aitken estimated it would cost £9 billion to retrofit around 450,000 homes across the Glasgow region, and that's over four times the City Council's budget, so you can see the wide gulf here and what needs to happen. Glasgow and Edinburgh in particular have to wrestle with the problems of retrofitting tenement flats, with an estimated 182,000 tenements across Scotland, and in Glasgow there are around 73,000 tenements. So these flats tend to be constructed with sandstone, and most were built in pre-1919, which makes energy efficiency solutions much more complicated. In April last year, the Nidrate Road project began, a pilot project to retrofit blocks of 8 tenements in Glasgow, and John Gilbert Architects, commissioned by Southside Housing Association, undertook a full retrofit of the flats, which were empty. It is a massive job, including the renovation, internal finishes and fittings, as well as the upgrading of external elements like the roof and stonework. So the project aims to assess the replicability of the lessons learned for Glasgow's wider pre-1919 tenement stock. However, the construction per flat is an incredible 88,000. So I make the point that's just to have a look to see what would actually be possible. Well, we can see the huge costs. And therefore, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, there's a huge number of issues to be addressed here, including the huge skills shortage, which will be a problem for retrofitting our homes. But I ask the Scottish Government to start engaging seriously with ordinary householders about how we will achieve these targets and consider the reality that people will need extensive financial help, but crucially, not just financial help, but on the type of heating systems that they can trust, alternatives which have been tried and tested, and that will directly benefit them, as well as making sure that we make the reduction in carbon emissions in our homes across Scotland. Ordinary people should not be paying a high price for a change that must benefit the whole of society.
Thank you. Thank you. I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do celebrate the ambitious targets for reaching net zero, but as others have commented, the scope, scale and complexity of the journey is significant, and none more so than the national challenge of retrofitting homes. It's not an incremental challenge. It requires an exponential scale up in an order of magnitude, and we've heard the estimate of £33 billion being referenced in this debate already. I propose today to make a few points about both the supply side and the demand side. On the supply side, there are significant barriers for manufacturers. The high capital expenditure to either create or repurpose existing manufacturing lines are an issue, and particularly for the smaller companies that we have currently operating in the market. For installers, there are early stage product risks, as well as, been mentioned previously, capacity issues that will limit scale-up. It will take time for these small companies also to build brand awareness. Most operators are currently SMEs, and this can also mean weak financial resilience and limited access to investment finance. For all involved in the supply side, there are the complex skills considerations, with the requirements still a bit of a movable feast. Because there's uncertainty, then there has to be hesitancy. On the demand side, despite briefing notes, and I quote, the high upfront costs and sometimes uncertain payback periods can put people off making changes to their home. I, like others in this debate, would put it more strongly than that. At this stage, there's no real demand from homeowners, particularly if they don't see their property as their forever home and in such uncertain economic times. Some of the costs being quoted today in the range of £12,000 to £17,000 will act as a major barrier. And another point is that new heating models are not yet seen as aspirational in the way the likes of electric cars are. Now, despite the urgency of the situation, costs are a concern for suppliers and consumers alike, and the ongoing assessment for manufacturers, installers, homeowners, renters and landlords will be required as initiatives come on stream. There are other challenges too. The Scottish National Investment Bank, capitalised with £2 billion over 10 years, has a key role in addressing market failure. But in the Finance Committee last week, we were hearing with the Enabling Internal Market Act leading to the Subsidy Control Bill, it's uncertain as to if and how SNP can operate as intended and contribute to the possibility of addressing market failure in retrofitting. Now, despite this bill passing the committee stage through the House of Commons, there's no definition of the rules as to how SNP and indeed the British Business Bank can meet their core purpose. Clarity is not expected from the UK government for some time, and the required rules may ultimately be developed by an unelected official in Bays without scrutiny by the House of Commons and bypassing this national parliament and Scottish government ministers. This uncertainty will also have a cooling effect on councils and other bodies, nervous about taking the risk of expensive and time-consuming legal challenges by trying to create programmes that address the issue we're discussing today. Some innovative financing has been looked at by attaching the funding to the property rather than the individual, but this can also encourage hesitancy in both future buyers and sellers, as we've seen with solar panels. On financing, a report by the Westminster-based All-Party Parliamentary Group for Fair Business Banking, of which I am an ambassador, makes an interesting point. I quote, "The SME-dominated retrofit supply chain largely falls between the cracks of existing investment funds and approaches. Too late stage and insufficiently high growth for venture capital, too early stage and high risk for institutional investors."
If you could conclude, please, Ms Thompson.
I will. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I celebrate Scotland's ambition to take the required steps forward, but as this debate proves, it's considerably more complex to get to where
Thank
we
you.
Need to be. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to refer members to my register of interest, as I am a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. We have heard some thought-provoking speeches this afternoon about retrofitting and transforming the construction industry to help achieve the overall net zero target. We have also heard calls for the Scottish Government to invest, be innovative and to outline how the retrofitting programme will be achieved so targets are not missed or opportunities squandered. As we know, we are up against the clock when it comes to climate change, and with 40% of total emissions coming from the construction and the built environment, there is a need to make the industry cleaner and greener. Although it will be a significant challenge to reduce emissions across Scotland and the rest of the UK, it also presents an opportunity for new and innovative ways for the building sector to retain and grow the workforce, improve the environment and also the quality of assets that are built. For new built housing estates, making homes more environmentally friendly is undoubtedly easier, as you are working with a blank canvas. However, a critical part of achieving net zero will be reducing carbon emissions from existing buildings. Areas like Glasgow, as we've heard, will be a particular challenge. However, we're already beginning to see developments in streets such as Nidri Road, which is seeing tenement flats being transformed without the iconic front-facing sandstone structure being damaged. And as someone who appreciates architecture and conserving the history of an area, it is important that the work carried out doesn't change the original landscape. But that being said, as my colleague Miles Briggs outlined in his opening remarks, we must make sure that these changes are made affordable for local people, as it would be a failed project should these programmes go ahead but the homes become unaffordable. And unfortunately, they are the concerns that we've heard from many members today in the Chamber. And I also agree with the comments made by Liam Kerr that transforming and making our housing stock a one-size-fits-all approach will not work, and there is a need to look at a mixed technology, especially in relation to heating and affordability. Moving on to upskilling the workforce, as this will be another key component of the retrofitting programme, is to be a success. We know that the CITB's report, Building Skills for Net Zero, that in order to meet climate change targets, an estimated 22,500 people in Scotland will need to be retrained or trained in energy efficiency by 2028. This roughly represents an increase of 9% of the current size of the workforce based on technology available and also the methods of working. Recruitment drives will be essential, and again, by looking at reskilling or apprenticeships, it could offer people of all ages an opportunity to learn a skill that should be in a job secure sector. But the government needs to start this recruitment drive now. As a member of the Local Government and Housing Committee and existing councillor in North Lanarkshire, I would like to touch on the key roles and responsibilities councils have to improve housing stock and to help meet net zero targets. I mentioned this earlier on when discussing Glasgow. However, every local authority will have to make homes more energy efficient and to develop a strategy across all tenures as well as their own housing stock. To do this, councils will need substantial backing and funding to carry out this huge challenge. And for the SNP Green Government, please take note, they need funding now. In addition, councils will also need to build new relationships with housing associations, as this will be vital to ensuring that there is a collegiate partnership to achieving the net zero target. To finish, Presiding Officer, it will come as no surprise that the Scottish Government must do more to meet their net zero targets and to make this a success. This requires the Scottish Government to hit the emissions targets they have failed to do so previously, invest in green housing and be upfront about where the money to decarbonise is coming from, as this has not been forthcoming, and to fund local government properly, as another real terms cut of £371 million this year is only going to hinder their net zero targets, as councils will struggle to deliver local strategies if this government continues to treat them with contempt. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Across the Chamber this afternoon, we've heard for many years now as well the absolute critical importance that tackling our carbon footprint will play in meeting the climate crisis head on. Like many in Glasgow Kelvin, I live and represent the Scottish constituency that actually has the highest ratio of flats. 96% of the accommodation in Kelvin consists of flatted dwellings, and 30% of Glasgow's pre-1919 tenemental housing is in Kelvin, with, of course, its associated challenges. At this point, I want to put on record my acknowledgement and admiration for how, in the past, the Housing Association movement has been at the vanguard of working towards low and zero carbon homes, particularly through energy efficiency measures and higher building specifications in the regeneration and new builds. Looking at the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, it hasn't gone unnoticed by me that in the 2020 and 2021 approvals for greener standards, more than half of approvals were for housing associations. In the past, they were accused of gold-plating their developments as if that was a bad thing. Their foresight, of course, has paid dividends, and many in the private sector now need to catch up with it. Recently, I wrote to every social housing provider in my constituency to better understand the challenges they face in decarbonising homes. The survey identified decarbonising heating systems, funding models for retrofits and skills shortages as a key issue, all of which, of course, are interrelated. Scottish Government funding is welcome, but they require new models of private investment in net zero and low carbon infrastructure too. In terms of the skills gap, the Construction Industry Training Board believes a revolution in our construction sector is needed to meet this challenge. I intend to do all I can to assist in transforming Scotland into a centre of excellence for greener jobs and careers. It's not only in our housing stock where these changes are necessary, but in all buildings. Only yesterday, I met with the Chief Executive of Visibility Scotland to discuss their plans for their headquarters based in the Woodside area of Kelvin. With a period property of substantial size and in need of significant improvement, this charity sees retrofitting as an exciting opportunity to safeguard their home for future generations while also making a workplace and service provision as energy efficient as possible. And I look forward to supporting them in these efforts to decarbonise. Very recently, I wrote to the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel, Tenants' Rights regarding low carbon initiatives and tenemental property. The transformation of tenemental properties to be lower carbon buildings is fraught, and obstacles where the objection of one owner can act as an effective veto against the plans of a majority to address climate action. Much of the legislation which can be used by a majority to force minority interests to act in tenemental property issues is related to maintenance and insurance and fails to address the transformative common works such as electric charging points and communal renewable heat and power systems. This, of course, relates to the owners of tenemental properties, but indirectly, of course, impacts on the quality of low-carbon housing for tenants too. I understand that this may require primary legislation through the changes, for instance, the Tenements Act of 2004 and other regulations. At this stage, I look forward to the Minister giving an indication as to whether legislative, regulatory or policy changes are in the offing to address these issues, and also whether the New Deal's tenants will have measures to require landlords to make their properties as energy efficient as possible. I'm mindful of time, Presiding Officer, so I'm just going to jump to the end here.
Please, very quickly.
Thank you. Highlighting our successes on this journey to net zero should therefore be welcomed, but also used to inspire greater change and at a faster pace. Thank you.
Presiding Officer, and sorry, have I been called?
You have, Mr.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Can I thank the committee for securing this debate this afternoon? Our homes are, of course, central to the zero carbon vision of the future, but they also tell us the stories about our past. Now, when we started retrofitting our own family home a number of years ago, we first discovered the hearth for the Victorian coal range. And the more that we progressed, uncovering the layers of the building, the more that we could see through the history, the changing needs for more living space, for better sanitation, and then electrification had shaped how the house had been retrofitted many times over many decades, firstly by councils and then latterly by private owners. So this drive for decarbonisation is really just the latest form of modernisation, although it will probably be the most transformational since the arrival of electricity in our homes. And this aim to decarbonise Scotland's 2.5 million homes, when only currently 11% of them have renewable or low emissions heating systems in place, does point to the scale of the challenge. Meanwhile, of course, soaring electricity and gas prices, reflected by Westminster's energy and taxation policies, are really fueling a cost of living crisis, with over 30% of homes estimated to be in fuel poverty. So we need to make sure that the delivery of energy-efficient housing will prioritise fuel-poor homes, especially in our rural and island communities, in a way that leaves no one behind. Now, programmes of government grants and loans, energy supplier and landlord obligations, fuel pricing and regulation, and area-based schemes will be critical to the delivery of the strategy. Local and community action has a crucial role to play, and the local heat and energy efficiency strategy pilots have shown just how important the role of councils and communities will be in driving the strategy forward. The development of the National Public Energy Agency and the National Infrastructure Company in the coming years will be a groundbreaking step towards ensuring councils are well equipped and leading on the action that's required to decarbonise our homes. And we need to ensure that local stakeholders are also part of all stages of the design and delivery of area-based schemes and strategies, and that councils are allocated sufficient funding to deliver as well. Now, you know, there are real intricacies with delivering retrofitting plans on the ground. I think we've heard some of that already in this debate, especially around making sure that local installers and tradespeople are geared up to respond. The CITB have estimated we need to train roughly 10% of the current size of our workforce in energy efficiency by 2028 in order to deliver that vision for decarbonisation. And there's an immediate need to strengthen the skills of the existing workforce to fill labour gaps and to deliver the pace and scale that is required. And I think the Minister spoke at the beginning of the debate about certainty. You know, I say to Miles Briggs, you know, certainty is important for business because it drives that investment, it establishes that long-term trajectory and creates that market, which I think will create jobs and will create the certainty for investment. Now, of course, there are complexities around tenure, rurality and housing type we've already heard about. And I think we can learn from examples or models of collective purchase and heat as a service about how we can simplify and accelerate the pace of retrofit. I'm glad to hear the Scottish Government has signed an MOU with the Danish Government. I think there'll be much to learn from the international experience, but there's much to learn from our communities as well. I'm a big fan of the work that the Heat Project does in Blairgowrie, working with individual householders about their retrofitting options and how they can cost-effectively get the grants and loans to deliver that. The commitment to retrofit 1 million homes by 2030 is ambitious and complicated, but that shouldn't stand in the way of action. It's our responsibility to deliver this vision in response to the climate emergency, tackle increasing rates of fuel poverty, and improve our health and well-being. It's our commitment
Please conclude.
To both people and planet. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Alex Rowley, the last speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a relatively short debate on what is, for so many, a major issue. The levels of fuel poverty in this country is unacceptable. The levels of ambition from the government to tackle fuel poverty is equally, in my view, unacceptable. And it is also a very topical, given the increasing costs involved and the fact that the UK price cap on energy bills, which stops companies from immediately passing rising costs on to their customers, is due to change from the 1st of April, when the industry regulator Ofgem is set to raise the cap dramatically. Currently, more than 15 million households across the UK are protected by the cap, so there is a very real cost of energy crisis heading our way. Speakers have today highlighted many concerns about the government's approach, not least the lack of detail and the levels of uncertainty on costs and support for people and households, as well as the cost being passed on to public authorities and social providers of housing. I also find it of concern that there is talk of using new technologies that have not been invented yet. It tends to sound a bit like wishful thinking. One thing I would like to touch on in this debate is the prospect of having to have this debate again and again in the future. This is down to the fact that we continue to build properties in the first instance that will need retrofitting in 10, 15 or 20 years' time. Obviously, this does not apply to already existing housing stocks, so the need for retrofitting is crucial. However, why continue to fuel the problem by continuing to build properties that will need work done on them in the future to meet our energy or carbon emissions targets? Members may be aware I am proposing a private member's bill on introducing new minimum building standards for all new builds in Scotland. Part of the purpose of this is to end the need for future retrofitting of properties by building them to an absolute best energy efficiency standard right now. When we see energy prices skyrocketing, you can see why introducing such measures becomes so important. After all, the cheapest energy is always the energy you don't use in the first place. I know the SNP and Green Government have said they will not support this recommendation from the Scottish Climate Assembly, but I have to ask them, do they really think it makes sense to continue building homes that we already know will need retrofitting at some point down the line? I haven't got time, sorry. We could take the necessary action right now and have Scotland leading the way in the future of housing across the world. The Heat in Building strategy had a £33 billion price tag, but only guaranteed £1.8 billion of funding. Scottish households are facing the very real possibility of costs of the improvements falling on them. This is causing real concern, especially in the middle of a cost of living crisis. SFHA modelling suggests that delivering this will cost social landlords around £2 billion. That is £7,000 per property to deliver a relatively modest impact on fuel poverty, with only 41% of properties achieving the targeted EPC B rating. And this is why part of the government's strategy must surely be to ensure that all new builds in Scotland are built to the gold standard, because to do so now is so much cheaper than to retrofit those properties in the years ahead. We must be more ambitious and very clear on how we intend to deliver on this crucial issue.
Thank you. I call Katie Clark, the first of the closing speeches, up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to close the debate on behalf of Scottish Labour and to welcome the work of the committee on what is clearly a very important issue. I think the convener highlighted very clearly the scale of the challenges that we have before us. And one of the issues that she focused on was the role of local government, which does have an important role, particularly where councils have their own council stock. North Ayrshire Council, for example, have installed solar panels on 500 council homes, with tenants keeping the energy savings. They have also built two sustainable demonstrator homes at Dixon Drive, Irvine, which have tested out the various technologies and, in particular, the financial benefits of those various technologies. As has been highlighted in this debate, one of the big issues is where the money is going to come from. And of course, the backdrop is a decade of cuts in council spending. So to do the kind of work that's necessary on the scale required, we do need a lot more detail from the Scottish Government about where the money is going to come from, so that the burden of investment doesn't fall on tenants' rents, and doesn't fall on ordinary working people. As has been said, the cost of house building is one of the issues that needs to be addressed, and indeed the cost to householders of retrofitting. The trend is that more people are living in older homes. And so the only way that we are going to meet our climate targets is if we retrofit existing housing stock and indeed other buildings. The condition of much of Scotland's existing housing stock in reality means that many people are locked into fuel poverty. We also know that poor housing conditions are associated with many illnesses and health conditions. Domestic stock is, of course, a significant source of carbon emissions. So we need to both revolutionise the way that we build houses, as Alex Riley has referred to, but also what we do with our existing homes. The STUC estimate that the retrofitting of homes could create 32,000 to 98,000 jobs in Scotland, and the retrofitting of other public and commercial buildings between 8,500 to 10,000 jobs. So, as well as addressing some of the climate issues that have been addressed in this debate, these issues also have massive social consequences. I welcome this debate. I welcome the highlighting by so many members across the political spectrum of the huge challenges that need to be addressed. I look forward to the Minister's response and the debate going forward to ensure that we meet the challenges that have been presented in this debate today and do what needs to be done to retrofit and ensure that we meet our climate standards.
Thank you. I call on Alexander Stewart, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, and I'd like to pay tribute to the committee for bringing it to the Chamber today. The importance and the complexity of this issue has been reflected by the debate that we've heard in the Chamber today, from very thoughtful contributions, yet we are still only scratching the surface on the issue. But the truth is that it's not possible to do full justice to this topic in one debate here today. I have no doubt that we will return to this topic on a number of occasions during this parliamentary session. But one thing is nevertheless clear, Presiding Officer. The retrofitting of Scotland's 2.5 million homes will be an essential step on the journey to net zero by 2045. And as we know, 13% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions and only 30% of Scotland's energy consumption is accounted for by Scotland's households. And as we've seen set out in the Climate Change Plan update, the emissions must already have fallen by 68% by 2030 in Scotland to meet these targets. But while there are certain areas, the heat and building strategy provides much needed clarity on where the targets can be achieved, there are other areas which require some more details, and we still require some more information. For example, a workforce in excess of 16,000 will be required to support retrofitting by 2030. And while this is a workforce assessment project due to be published this year, we know that training a workforce of that size will be a significant challenge. Years of underinvestment in many areas of skills shortages have already seen serious problems, something which was only debated last week in this very chamber. We also know that the worldwide labour market is continuing to undergo unprecedented changes, for example, the shortage of skills in many areas. And we also know that skill shortages will inevitably lead to certain parts of the country. Rural and island communities, for example, may have much more to deal with in this whole process. The Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, for example, has warned that training will be required to ensure that retrofit will take place, and that accreditation is available in Scotland only since October, meaning that many companies are already well behind in that stage and going forward. Concerns have also been raised about the requirement of staff who will reach the SQV level 6 and will mean that there will need to be participation. And many rural companies already have, Presiding Officer, and decided not to go for the retrofitting market, instead returning to the fitting standard renovations. The success of the heat and building strategy hinges on the ability for individuals and problems of this to be solved. But there is issues that further clarity is still required. Homeowners accept the retrofitting, but it doesn't come at a cost neutral. Regardless of the issues that were there, we know that there's an expectation of £33 billion costs to be covered. And we also know that there's only £1.8 billion committed by the government so far. So there's a massive gap. Many members have made some very strong contributions this afternoon, and I'd like to reflect on them. The convener herself talked about the planning process and identified that many areas, and that may be an area of conflict, and the convener is right to identify this issue, because planning could well be a problem for the process going forward. My colleague Miles Briggs spoke about the challenges and the ambitions. There's nothing wrong with the ambition that we have, but it's the challenge of trying to meet that and to ensure that tenants and householders can do that. Energy bills already are increasing, and fuel poverty already is with us, presiding officer. That needs to be addressed. Mark Griffin spoke about the cost of hitting these targets. It's important that there's money up front, because if you don't have that money up front, these targets will never be met, and how low-income households are at risk of being able to afford the challenges. District heating systems and schemes have had mixed response. Liam MacArthur talked about the funding, £12,000 per household on average, but also talked about the rural and island. That would be much, much higher. We have to identify the capacity and deliver and ensure that we have that capacity. Liam Kerr spoke about off-grid. Fuel poverty exists now. Electricity heat pumps may not be the best way forward. Off-grid homes are a major concern, and they have to be looked at for the sustainability of going forward. So I'd like to conclude by thanking all these organisations and individuals who gave us briefings going forward on this, presiding officer. Retrofitting Scotland's homes will be a key element in reducing Scotland's carbon emissions, and one which will require a joint effect and a joint effort between central and local government. So there will have to be that meeting of the minds to ensure that local government and central government come up with the needs, because homeowners and landlords will require it. As we've heard today, there were still a number of issues to overcome in order to achieve this, and these benches will continue pushing the government to give the momentum that's required to ensure that we see issues going forward, because we don't want to miss these opportunities. We don't want to miss these targets. But it's misleading to say that we can achieve everything in the timescales we have, because it's not the case. The money needs to be there, and we need to make sure that we're not leaving people behind, because communities and constituents deserve that support and that mechanism. And if we want to achieve that, then we have to ensure that. So as I said, these benches will continue to support the things going forward, but we'll also ask questions and continue to ensure that questions are answered and that individuals and communities are given the opportunity. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you. I call on Patrick Harvey. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, presiding officer. And I'd like to thank everyone who's taken part in the debate. There have been a number of areas of cross-party consensus. I would like to hope that I misunderstood the last part of the final speech, which at some point sounded like a call for slowing down, saying that we cannot deliver on the timescale that we're committed to. The timescale that we're committed to, of course, is designed to be consistent with the climate targets that this entire Parliament has voted for. So I hope that the cross-party engagement that we have is about how we do this, not whether we do this, and not whether we should slow down. The committee should be commended for the work in bringing forward not only its evidence session, but also the constructive correspondence they've had with myself and other ministers, and for bringing this debate. I probably won't, presiding officer, have time to address every issue, and that's partly because this is a cross-cutting issue, as several members mentioned. It does deal with the remit of the Housing Local Government and Planning Committee. It also deals with the remit of the NZ Committee. It also deals with social security. It deals with skills. There are health and equalities issues. This is an agenda which covers an incredible breadth, not just my own portfolio and not just the remit of a single committee. So I've no doubt that there will be many opportunities to continue to discuss the issues that I don't manage to cover in my closing speech. I want, of course, to mention some of the issues that were raised, first of all, by the main opposition parties in opening the, the debate, both Labour and Conservative emphasised some of the current issues around energy bills, fuel poverty and the cost of living. They're right, absolutely, to raise those issues. If we were in a position in this Parliament of being able to debate tariffs, levies, VAT, the price cap, or the idea of a windfall tax on fossil fuel companies to provide support for this transition, no doubt we would have a lively debate and all parties would bring their ideas to the table. These issues, of course, are decided at UK level, and even the issue of rebalancing gas and electricity prices, which is going to be important. We pressed on that with the UK government, and I do hope that those members who don't agree that those powers should be exercised here will work with us to press the UK government to take that action that's necessary. Both Miles Briggs and Mark Griffin also raised, from slightly different perspectives, some of the issues around the experiences that people have had in the past of existing schemes that have replaced fossil fuel with zero emission heating or indeed of energy efficiency measures. I think Miles Briggs mentioned social housing tenants he's been in touch with who've had a bad experience. I have to say I'm aware of some cases like that. I've also visited many who say the opposite, who've saved more than half of their heating bills and have reliable, controllable heat as a result of switch to air source heat-pumped, fuelled heating networks. But I think the point here, though, is that whatever happens in, as I say, a multi-decade programme of work, we should avoid treating either the best or the worst individual experiences as a stereotype. Even fossil fuel heating systems and other forms of home improvement have seen good and bad practice. I think Mark Griffin used the term cowboys active in the field. I should say, because nobody else has teased him yet, it's traditional for members to say thank you to the Minister for providing the advance sight of the statement. I return the compliment. But the range of technologies that Mark Griffin mentioned, our emphasis is on what are known as low and no regret measures. And I recognise, as I said in my opening speech, that many of these are less familiar in Scotland, but they are tried and tested technologies that have been used successfully in many other countries. What's going to be critical to replicating those other countries' experience of using these technologies well in Scotland is building the skills that are needed to design, deliver and maintain those new systems to the highest standard. Emphasis on supporting those who are most in need, and we agree on that, was another theme in Mark Griffin's speech and in others. And indeed, the Warmer Home Scotland scheme has helped tens of thousands of households most in need, saving an average of £300 per annum per household. And the successor scheme must continue to do that, as well as sharing, enabling the ambitious emission reduction goals which Scotland has set, and helping those who are in hard-to-treat properties, which might be what Liam MacArthur wants to raise.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. I talked in my own speech about the scale of the ambitions in terms of the skills development that would be required to scale up the operations in terms of these installations. There's still going to be a requirement to service existing boilers, etc. So how is that capacity conundrum going to be met by the government?
Minister.
Yes, indeed. I mean, many of the arguments that I made in the opening speech about giving certainty to the industry and to the supply chain to invest in acquiring and sharing those skills, that's going to be critical. And that's why a clear and a bold approach to regulation is going to be important. In relation to regulation, several members, both from an urban and a rural perspective, have raised the issue of buildings with mixed ownership, mixed tenure and mixed use, including Cochab Stewart, my own constituency MSP. I live in one of those mixed tenure, mixed owner, mixed use pre-1919 tenement blocks in Cochab Stewart's constituency. And we're very aware of the particular challenges in relation to those. I would like to expand the point, if
the
I
Minister
can.
The Minister is in his last 30 seconds.
Our approach is actively considering how those buildings will be incorporated into our approach to regulations, and there may need to be differences in relation perhaps to compliance periods or the trigger points that are going to be used. We're establishing a short life working group to look at the options for the regulatory approach to tenement buildings, tenements in the broadest sense, and we'll also follow on from the recommendations from the Parliamentary Working Group on Tenement Maintenance. And the Scottish Law Commission will be undertaking a law reform project with a view to producing a draft tenement maintenance bill. Presiding Officer, I recognise that I'm over time. I haven't managed to touch on every issue that I would have wished to. I'm sure this won't be the last opportunity to debate what is, as I say, going to be an extremely long-term agenda in the years and decades ahead. But I thank once again the committee for bringing the debate.
Thank you. I now call on Eleanor Whittam to wind up the debate on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I start, I refer members to my register of interest. I'm Stella Councillor in East Ayrshire. I'm very pleased to be closing this extremely important debate on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And as the convener said at the beginning of the debate, we are just beginning our work on retrofitting of housing to net zero. From my perspective, this debate has been immensely constructive in helping us to shape what our next steps should be on this issue. I think this debate has affirmed for me the huge challenge ahead of us to meet the Scottish Government's ambitions for the retrofitting of housing for net zero, but it's also emphasised the importance of meeting that challenge and the significant contribution reducing emissions from housing will make in meeting our overall net zero target. Whilst we recognise the enormity of the challenges ahead of us, it is reassuring to hear from all sides of the Parliament today that we share a collective commitment to overcoming them. We need to think in radical and innovative ways to meet these challenges, and it is great to hear today that there are creative and innovative approaches that could be considered. And as part of that, we need to think about delivering on retrofitting in a way that improves people's lives too, that enables people to live in homes that are conducive to better health and do not push people into fuel poverty or exponentially increase rents. This needs to be delivered in a manner that is consistent with a just transition. We have a very important role as a committee and as a parliament more generally to hold the Scottish Government to account and ensure that we are doing all that we can to deliver on the ambitions for retrofitting. So turning to some members' contributions, this is the first time I've ever done this, so bear with me, folks. And the Minister was right at the beginning to point out that this is an immense challenge and it needs scale and pace. Also right to raise that the public awareness has been raised since COP26, but we still need to raise it further, and this is going to be something that is going to be necessary in the immediate future. And the committee also looks forward to seeing the legislation that you mentioned being brought forward, and you know, we will scrutinise that because there is a real big need for careful scrutiny to ensure that the public understands why the need for change is there and how they can make the changes and how they can fund it. And it's vital that the Green Heat Task Force that the Minister mentioned helps to drive innovation and helps to unlock the private investment and to complement the public monies that are going to be available. Miles Briggs at the outset spoke actually about wall and floor insulation could be an early starter, an early driver for change, given those that are in difficult rural properties somewhere to start and focus on, and given the fuel poverty rates that are huge in the rural settings. And Mark Griffin again is right to raise the issue of fuel poverty that can be exacerbated by inefficient homes, and the reality is that many of these homeowners will find the costs prohibitive, and the no detriment principle is really key here, and I share his concerns regarding cowboy builders. We have seen this in the past with other schemes when it comes to energy efficiency. Liam MacArthur also underlined the issue of rural and island fuel poverty and their vastly higher costs for retrofitting. I mean, this is potentially over £17,000 for each property, and we need to understand how people are going to be able to fund that. Paul McLennan outlined to ultimately reduce fuel poverty in the long term, decarbonising homes with low carbon fuel efficient measures will be key, but also underlined the importance of the no detriment principle and the need for all governments to work collaboratively on this issue. And Liam Kerr raised the really huge issue of the 70,000 off-grid homes that exist. There's some in my own council area that we've had to deal with and supply fuel pumps. And the costs and difficulties in retrofitting such properties and spoke of there being a no one-size-fits-all, which is key to tackling this. Fergus Ewing passionately raised the issues of his constituent who lives in a listed building. I myself live in one of them too. And the associated issues the committee has already started to explore with the tensions between planning consent and retrofitting, and also the really important issue of the missing share schemes. And I think there's quite a lot of those schemes, including in my own authority of East Ayrshire, and they're going to be important going forward. Pauline McNeill reinforced the financial supports are required and raised the concerns regarding a lack of consumer confidence in emerging and changing technologies. And this is really important because consumers have to have the confidence to go ahead with such big financial transactions. And Michelle Thompson rightly pointed out that this is an exponential challenge, £33 billion price tag, and she highlighted the need to upskill and support our small and medium enterprises in order that they can help us to meet this challenge, and rightly underlined the skill shortage that we're having to address, which was talked about by many members today. And Megan Gallagher also discussed the desire to preserve our built heritage, which is important for so many of us, and how this can compete with retrofitting. And again, we need to find solutions for this. And, yes.
Paul Sweeney.
I'm sure well aware of the Built Environment Forum Scotland Tenement Maintenance Working Group and their particular concerns that the pace in which legislation has been brought through, and particularly the capacity issues with the Scottish Law Commission looking at potential legislation, is really problematic. And I think we could potentially look at how we accelerate that effort to try and get that legislation through as quickly as possible.
Helena Whittam.
I thank Paul Sweeney for that intervention, and I would agree with him. And I think that that's something that the committee is definitely going to have to be very mindful of and use in our scrutiny work. Now, I've forgotten where I was and knew that was going to happen to me my first time. Yep, COCAG Stewart, you know, highlighted the 96% of her constituency is in tenemental period properties and the huge challenge that arises from this, as highlighted by her own survey. And Mark Ruskell eloquently pointed out how his own period property has been retrofitted numerous times over the years as technology advanced, but recognised that the scale of retrofitting is a mountain in front of us. Now, interestingly enough, the final contribution in the open debate from Alex Rowley reinforced the very real issue of the looming fuel cost crisis and the never-ending cycle of retrofitting, which I thought was quite interesting coming straight after Mark Ruskell's contribution. And I think that, you know, the issue of building to a gold standard now is quite something that the committee is going to have to focus on. I think we do have to recognise, as technology emerges all the time, we are going to see a continual retrofitting regardless of getting to a gold standard at the moment. But that was a very interesting contribution, I thought. So I thank the Parliament for the opportunity for this debate, and I hope that by the time we come back to consider this issue in the Chamber again, we will do so reflecting on real progress, that we will see local and national strategies that offer clear pathways to the delivery of the retrofitting agenda, that funding is in place through a combination of sources to support that delivery, that people know how to access that funding, that the public understands what is required of them and why it's so necessary, and that we're delivering the retrofitting agenda in a way that's consistent with a just transition, and that there's a skilled workforce across Scotland able to deliver on this agenda irrespective of where you live in this country. And finally, that the conversations with the UK government have progressed on the issue of VAT on retrofit work and electricity tariffs, thereby removing the obstacles in the way of our ambitions for retrofitting. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on retrofitting of properties for net zero. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of a legislative consent motion. And I call on Keith Brown to move motion number 2801 on judicial review and courts bill UK legislation. Cabinet Secretary, we couldn't hear you in the chamber.
Just to say it moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 2850 on committee membership. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 2801, in the name of Keith Brown, on judicial review and courts bill UK legislation be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 2850 in the name of George Adam on committee membership be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time and we'll move on to members' business.